Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Protests in Guatemala demand resignation of President Alejandro Giammattei. Rio Tinto workers in Canada go on strike against temporary contracts. WHO calls for moratorium on booster doses as vaccine divide grows. Vale appeals court-ordered compensation for 2019 Brumadinho Dam tragedy. Thousands of people across Guatemala have been taking to the streets since July 29th. Protesters are demanding the resignation of right-wing President Alejandro Giammattei and his cabinet. Unrest has grown against widespread corruption and the government's pandemic response. As of August 5th, Guatemala had recorded over 377,000 cases and 10,524 deaths. The pandemic has worsened economic conditions, with around 59% of people living below the poverty line. Guatemala ranks 6th in the world in terms of malnutrition as per the UN. The country is among the 23 global hotspots where hunger is expected to rise in the next 3 months. It is in this context that tens of thousands of Guatemalans observed a national strike on July 29th. Indigenous communities, trade unions, students and social movements are all part of the struggle. People are also demanding the resignation of Attorney General Maria Consuelo Porras. This was after she dismissed the head of the Special Prosecutor's Office Against Impunity, or FECI, Juan Francisco Sandoval. He later stated that he was prevented from investigating corruption cases with links to the president. These included cases related to the acquisition of COVID-19 vaccines and supplies. Fearing for his safety, Sandoval fled the country shortly after he was dismissed. Protests continued on August 5th under the banner of Plurinational Strike 5A. The call was issued by ancestral indigenous authorities to demand that Sandoval be reinstated. The indigenous Mayan, Garifuna and Xinka communities have been at the forefront of the struggle. Roadblocks were organized in several areas on Thursday, including Cubilguitz, Alta Verapaz, Camotan and San Vicente Pacaya. Unions and members of the Association of University Students have also held protests. They have denounced the 2021 budget, which will impose cuts on education and health. In our next story, we go to Canada, where workers employed by Rio Tinto are in their second week on strike. Around 900 workers at a smelting facility in Kitimat and a power plant in Kimano walked out on July 25th. Organized by the Unifor Union, they are protesting the company's refusal to hire full-time workers. Negotiations between Rio Tinto and the union had started on June 7th. Unifor stated that it had proposed changes to workers' retirement income for the first time in 10 years. It had also asked to move younger workers from defined contribution to defined benefit pension plans. The talks were taking place based on over 300 worker grievances. These were related to the company's use of temporary contract labor. As per Rio Tinto's new terms, a temporary employee would have to work 2,080 hours straight to qualify for company seniority benefits. Moreover, if someone worked less than 1,040 hours straight in a six-month block, they would lose their benefits for the next 6 months. Unifor also stated that the temporary employees would not be eligible for earned time off during preferred periods. The company also proposed cuts to post-retirement healthcare coverage for people hired after July 2021. The union issued a 72-hour strike notice on July 21st. However, Rio Tinto approached the Labor Relations Board to get some workers classified as essential employees. The company announced on July 26 that it would maintain its operations at 35%. As of August 5th, there had been no talks between the company and Unifor. The WHO has called for a moratorium on booster doses of COVID-19 vaccines. This follows news that several countries, including Israel and the US, might administer a third dose. This will be done to protect vulnerable populations against newer variants of the virus. WHO head Tedros Adhanom has asked countries to halt these plans till September. This is so that at least 10% of the world's population can be vaccinated. Over 4 billion doses have been administered globally so far. Out of this, more than 80% have gone to middle-income and middle-upper and high-income countries. 101 vaccine doses are being given per every 100 people in high-income countries. The figure for the poorest countries stands at 1.7 doses per 100 people. The US and European countries on average have inoculated at least 50% of the population, meanwhile only 1.8% of people on the African continent have been fully vaccinated. COVID-19 deaths in Africa reached a record peak in the week that ended on August 1st. As per the WHO, 6,400 deaths were reported, marking a 2% rise. South Africa and Tunisia alone accounted for over 55% of the casualties. Until the start of July, Senegal had recorded less than 44,000 cases and 1,166 deaths. However, the country documented more than 20,000 cases and 250 deaths in the last month alone. 12 million doses were delivered to Africa through the COVAX initiative in July. In order to fully vaccinate 10% of the population by September, the continent will need 183 million more doses. And for a final story, we'll look at the 2019 Brumadinho Dam collapse in Brazil. On January 25th, a tailings dam owned by the Vale Mining Company suffered a major failure. The dam was located at an iron ore mine in the state of Minas Gerais. The collapse triggered a mud flow that ran through the mine's offices and houses, roads and farms located nearby. 272 people were killed, 131 of whom were workers directly linked to Vale. A labor court ruled in June that the company must give 1,000 million reals in compensation to the families of each worker. However, Vale recently filed an appeal against the court's decision. Here's a video feature by Brazil De Fato on this issue.
After Vale's appeal to reverse the indemnity payment to the families of workers killed in its 2019 environmental crime, the Federal University of Minas Gerais released a technical note on the case. The document contests the arguments and actions of the mining company.
We wrote in the technical note that the company made a deliberate choice to increase the efficiency of mineral extraction to the detriment of the well-being and life of its employees.
The study argues that death damage should be applied in this case, although this type of indemnity is not explicit in the Brazilian criminal code.
What is death damage? These are the moral damages that the company owes to the fatal victims. Minutes before the collapse of the dam, this dead man was alive. He was a living person who saw the mud rush over his body. He saw the imminent death.
According to the Metabase Union, plaintiff of the action received by the labor court, the lack of legal precedents favors the company. The labor reform, which entered into force in 2017, also hampers the possibility of an indemnity.
This one is a new decision on which the labor court does not have other decisions to base its views. We pay too low amounts of compensation in the labor court. The situation was aggravated by the labor reform, which seeks to establish a ceiling for these indemnities, something unconstitutional from our point of view and from the Constitution's point of view.
The union made a new appeal to seek the review of the indemnity amounts in addition to the application of law. For the university researchers, it is the judiciary's role to change the way companies as Vale operates in order to prevent new tragedies from happening.
We currently have 47 critical level dams in Brazil. 28 of these dams are Vale's direct responsibility. So the question is, when will the next tragedy be?
And that's all the time we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Thank you for watching.